Well, good afternoon, or good early evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this wonderful venue, the Gustav Tuck Lecture Theatre, for the 8th Peter Hall Annual Lecture. I'm Michael Hebert, Professor of Town Planning with the Bartlett School of Planning here at UCL, and I'm standing in for Nick Gallant, who's just left the room on his way to Heathrow to give a public lecture in Hong Kong. So it's my job to introduce the introducer, John Tominey, who will introduce the speaker. So welcome again to this high point of our public lecture series. And it's right to begin, as the banner begins, with a word of thanks to the sponsors, Capita, who make possible this wonderful series of lectures, Capita Property and Infrastructure. Peter Hall Lectures were founded back in 2008, so this is the 8th lecture, and there weren't memorial lectures. I mean, Peter was with us here for the 6 of the 8 lectures, and they were very much designed around his active participation, sitting in the front row. He died, sadly, 2 years ago in July, so he can't be here in the front row, but Magda is, and you're very, very welcome, Magda, and guests. The point about it was that Peter not only attended, but always asked the first question and was always right on the ball of the topic, whatever the topic might be. And we still miss him. We miss him for his vitality, for his intellectual versatility, for his ability to get the ball rolling on any topic of discussion. And perhaps it's particularly relevant to think about Peter this evening when the topic is social diversity. Because those of us who've written and are still writing obituaries of Peter Hall and the demand for commemorative perspectives on him continues. Got an email yesterday from the Dictionary of National Biography for that entry. Those of us who are involved in sort of setting down the record of Peter's contribution have to sort of think of his critics, because all academics are criticised. And he was most strenuously criticised by an Australian academic, a specialist in social diversity, but not the one we're going to hear from this evening. But Leonie Sandercock had a jolly good go at Peter for as representing a sort of patriarchal, male, class-bound, and Anglo-Saxon perspective on planning and planning history. And Peter's response to that was a very interesting one, which was that he went off and became director of the Institute of Community Studies, which is an applied social research institute embedded in the most socially diverse part of East London. And he wrote a book in 2007, so only 9 years ago, called London Voices and London Lives, which is one of the most remarkable celebrations of urban diversity that you'll ever encounter, because it's a book expressed partly through his analysis, but mostly through the voices of Londoners, Londoners of every hue and position. And I'm just sort of remembering that book, plucking it off the shelves, and also rereading some of the reviews. I mean, the review in the journal Critical Social Policy, for example, which says that this book and the voices in it successfully convey an impression of London as not only a deeply divided and fragmented place, but also a city where many inhabitants feel besieged with constant changes threatening to overwhelm their lives. So it's this Peter Hall who I invite you to remember and celebrate, as I invite John to introduce our speaker on that very theme. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Michael. As Michael has said, my task is to introduce this evening's speaker and at the same time keep the Queen's peace as we proceed. It's my great pleasure to welcome Ruth Fincher to UCL. Ruth is Redmond Barry Distinguished Professor Emeritus at the University of Melbourne and one of Australia's leading geographers. Known most as an urban geographer with research and teaching interests, as we'll hear, in immigration and multiculturalism in the city, diversity and difference, gender issues, inequality and locational disadvantage, and urban planning. Ruth began her academic career as an undergraduate at the University of Melbourne. She did a master's degree at McMaster University in Ontario and a PhD in the Graduate School of Geography at Clark University in Massachusetts. She taught geography at McGill and McMaster in Canada before joining the University of Melbourne in the 1980s. In the 1990s, she worked on secondment as manager of research at the Australian Federal Government's Bureau of Immigration Research. So she's one of those people, a bit like Peter, who's moved from academic to policy, between the academic and policy worlds. She has had a very distinguished career at the University of Melbourne, where she was Director of the Australia Centre, Dean of the Faculty of Architecture, Building and Planning, Professor of Urban Planning, before finally holding the University's Chair in Geography from 2006 to 2015. From 2012 to 2014, she served as President of the Academic Board of the University, a much more powerful institution at Melbourne than it is here. Professor Fincher was president of the University of Melbourne's Academic Board in 2013 and 14, and she served as pro-vice-chancellor of the university. She's a fellow of the Academy of Social Sciences in Australia, a distinguished fellow of the Institute of Australian Geographers, and in January 2014 was appointed a member of the Order of Australia. She's written many influential books, notably Planning and Diversity in the City, co-authored with Kurt Iverson, which has been a very influential book among colleagues here at BSP, influencing both their research and teaching. So this concern with poverty, inequality, is a recurring theme in her work. As I said, she's best known internationally perhaps for her work on planning and diversity, and it's on this topic we've asked her to speak to this evening because it speaks to research which is ongoing in the Bartlett School of Planning. Ruth plans to speak for about 50 minutes, then there will be time for questions. And afterwards, I'll invite you to join us for drinks in the South Cloister. So without further ado, I'd like to say, Ruth, welcome to London, to UCL, and to the Bartlett, and the floor is yours.
Welcome to you all, and I would like to thank Professor John Tamani and colleagues here at University College London at the Bartlett School very much for the kind invitation to speak to you this evening. It's a very great honour indeed to be asked to present the annual Sir Peter Hall Lecture. I myself never met Peter Hall, as I was saying earlier to Magda, although numerous of my colleagues in planning at the University of Melbourne did know him well. His writing, though, as we all recognise, leaves an extraordinary legacy of thinking about the future of social life and how the form and activities of our cities are so very vital to that. I think his work also exemplifies that basic tenet of research and practice in urban planning, which I especially notice who's someone who's moved back and forth between geography and planning, that there's always something that can be done to make things better, and that we have intelligent normative views about what this might be, and it's our obligation always to be addressing ourselves to that, rather than just formulating critiques of what has been done. Peter Hall often wrote of the UK and Europe, drawing lessons often for the UK from Europe. And I think we in Australia could certainly use someone of his calibre now to bend the ears of our policymakers as we embark on a new era of a really new reality of having our very first Minister for Cities in our federal government. So as John has noted, I was asked to talk this evening about my work on planning and diversity, which has been conducted with Professor Kurt Iverson of the University of Sydney over the last decade. And as I do begin to talk about this, I really want to acknowledge what an inspiration it's been to collaborate with Kurt on this subject. So, hope this will work. Here's what I'm going to do in my talk. So I've got three sections. First of all, a brief introduction on diversity and the social commitment of planning. Then in a second section, I'm going to talk about some of the characteristics of diversity thinking in contemporary urban studies and planning, the way it talks about norms, the focus it takes on identity, the question of whether diversity hides unjust difference. And then in a third section, I'm going to offer some alternatives that I see emerging in the contemporary literature that place diversities together rather than focusing on them separately. And we'll talk about the question of encounter, the question of invisibility and the stranger, and the question of the urban commons. So, let me go on then into my first section and talk about diversity and the social commitment of planning. You'll know that certain planning scholars have, one of whom Michael mentioned earlier, have had an engagement with feminism and an acknowledgement of multiculturalism in much of their work in urban planning over the last couple of decades. And that group of people has made an important critique of the public, that group in whose interests planning has long been said to occur. The heterogeneity of the public has been claimed, and indeed the existence of multiple publics. To me, this discussion is central to the idea of the social and the interesting question of what the social is in planning if it no longer references a homogeneous population with interests in common that can be assumed and planned for. There is, of course, the compelling argument put 20 years ago by the political and social theorist Nicholas Rose here in the UK of what he called the death of the social as a favoured territory of government. Rose argued that here a uniform or overarching social is not a primary target of governmental action anymore. Any idea that we are part of a social, a body that links us all, has been replaced, he said, along with thinking about the welfare state, by a division of governed populations into communities and identities to which they and governance actions about them have allegiance. So we are not all the same. As he says, quote, consider the contemporary salience of the vocabulary of community care, community homes, community workers, community safety, for example. All these seem to signal that the social may be giving way to the community as a new territory for the administration of individual and collective existence, unquote. And we might add identity to his idea of community. So if the overarching social as an object of governance has largely gone, along with a belief in a uniform public interest in urban studies and planning, are these comforting grand categories now replaced by something we might term diversity? That is, the patchy identification of certain population groups in certain places and their designation often as policy targets when construed politically as social problems, in the way that Keith Jacobs and others have argued. Certainly, if we read some accounts of what social planning is, it's clear that the task of planning for social needs and priorities is seen in terms of planning for specific and separate population groups who are often minority groups. Kurt Iverson and I, when we wrote our planning theory book in 2008, were determined not to write a book with one chapter on each of a series of designated social groups or identity groups in the city. Rather, we sought to understand planning for social diversity and the production of social difference in a different way from that altogether. We felt that it's important that as we develop new understandings of the social that see its fractions and groupings, we also understand that harms may be done by representing groups and their identities in certain ways, for example, as marginal. Exclusions may result as well as inclusions of new perspectives and interests. So where does diversity take us if we're interested in the social in our thinking about planning? Can diversity thinking inhabit the idea of the social in such a way as to take it beyond separating people into groups with particular characteristics? So in this talk, I use the idea of diversity to try and sort of reanimate the concept of the social and to see if the good aspect of the idea of the social, which is that we're all in this together somehow, can nevertheless respect differences between people in their cultural identities, rootedness in different places, politics and values, which is the good part of a focus on community and diverse social groups. Diversity in its common use principally refers to the varied characteristics of the population, often also with reference to their situatedness in places. Terms like multiculturalism, identity-related politics and policies, and the recognition of difference sit alongside that of diversity. With diversity, I always think the very least well specified theoretically. These sorts of terms have formed a conceptual apparatus that enables us to analyse the embodied forms of injustice as well as justice in the city, particularly the racialised and sexualised forms of this. I note that the term diversity now also has a significant presence in research and practice about organisations. Since the late 20th century, efforts have been made to identify the characteristics of employees in order to limit discrimination against them. And there is critical discussion about this in management research that often focuses on how human resources practices deal with it. And you'll see some of this in the wonderful writing of the feminist theorist Sarah Ahmed, for example. But theoretically and practically, the way we use the concept of diversity, and indeed the work it does for us in applied settings, has become quite contentious. Perhaps its use has encouraged us to take too strong a focus on variation and difference. So in this talk, as I've said, I want to raise some of the alternatives to a focus on diversity as the simple recognition of separateness and difference, which a response to these critiques requires us to consider. How may we retain our sensitivity to the presence of a variety of social groups and interests in the places of our cities and yet appreciate the interests in common that we share as part of the social? How may we as planning scholars acknowledge diversity appropriately and document ways in which it's contributing positively as well as negatively to our ideas of the functioning social? So I want to go on then to my section where I talk about diversity thinking as it often currently happens in urban studies and social planning. So, what are the characteristics of diversity thinking as we now often engage in it? And the first characteristic I want to mention of diversity thinking is that it's often normative, even justice seeking. In writing about the city and urban policies, diversity is sought after, usually as a good thing. But this needs to be interrogated. As Loretta Lees commented a decade ago, quote, the diversity of different diversities is often under-theorised, unquote. She meant that it's not enough in urban research to describe or embrace variations and quaint examples where things are done differently between us. Rather, if we're seeking justice or redress or progressive improvements of some sort, we need to identify those accepted forms of diversity in our communities that can cause damage to some groups or render them inferior. Then our work can single out harmful judgments and canvas ways to reduce the injustice meted out to people having certain characteristics. She echoes the thinking of the eminent Australian urbanist Hugh Stretton, who wrote way back in 1970, quote, any decent intellectual despises the difference of more and less and reveres the difference of originality, unquote. In our 2008 book about planning and diversity, Kurt Iveson and I identified three norms, as if you've read it, you'll know, redistribution, recognition and encounter, which we posited as core values of progressive social planning in our attempt to ground some debates of feminist philosophy materially and spatially. These norms, we thought, would direct us to seeing the negative manifestations of diversity in specific ways, so that they could be countered in planning actions. So the norm of redistribution pushes us to interrogate whether certain citizens are economically disadvantaged in their access to the resources of the city. Recognition causes examination of whether cultural or social features in certain groups of people are matters leading to discrimination against them. Encounter asks whether there are ways of bypassing some negative effects due to isolation and segregation if citizens interact across their differences by being engaged in tasks of interest to them all. In this work, of course, builds on the pioneering contributions of feminist philosophers like Nancy Fraser and R.S. Marion Young. It also rests on the pioneering work in urban planning of my colleague Leonie Sandercock, with its portrayal of the diversities and power imbalances of the cosmopolis. The use of theorised norms has in recent writing, however, been subject to challenge. How can broad concepts derived from philosophy possibly be of use in revealing the lived diversity of daily life in the city? Indeed, some writers have rejected the use of philosophically posited norms at all. So Clive Barnett recently claimed that instead we should see norms as intuited in the material practice of social groups or activist movements, as evolving in the moment rather than as strictures on practice and previously known. With the materialist and performative turn of contemporary critical urban studies, the locating of norms in everyday actions rather than above and outside daily practice is certainly important. And it has implications for planning if one believes that planning our cities requires reference to norms, as I'm sure Peter Hall believed, rather than its outcomes and ideas of success being entirely focused on process. But being aware of the embeddedness of norms in material practices doesn't mean that accepting those norms only emerged from such practices anew every time and cannot be conceptualised until after that fact is what one should believe, I think. Clearly, activists in movements for the right to the city and environmental justice, for example, to take Clive Barnett's actual examples, have goals in mind before they proceed, and they are aware of past struggles. So rather, it's the nature of the dialogue between foundational norms and analysis of situations and actions in the world, I believe, not the priority of one over the other, that matters the most. Even if the specification of norms of justice is tentative and suggestive, such specification is necessary. It's really very helpful, as you will have seen if you've read my book, to be able to name one's normative principles in making an analysis of situations. A second characteristic of diversity thinking is that it focuses a lot of attention on groups defined with respect to an individual embodied attribute or identity, where we might include in that list ethnicity, gender, age, sexuality. It can be locked in to classifying groups, thus detracting from a focus on people of diverse characteristics interacting together. Further, this way of thinking about diversity can lead to the researcher or institution or policymaker really seeing groups and people within them as actually defined by such single characteristics, a kind of social ecological fallacy, perhaps. So I think back to a large study in which I was involved in the late 2000s, where the purpose was to find out how international students in central Melbourne were creating a sense of belonging for themselves as new and temporary immigrants through encounters with their peers. In that study, though its categories of identity for students weren't totally named as embodied ones, much attention was paid to interactions between the central groups of students that the universities saw and that we as researchers embedded in the university therefore saw too, which were international groups and domestic students, international students and domestic students. The result of that over-specification of student groups via institutional identities was that we tended to see the encounters that we thought were positive and across difference as between international and domestic student groups, where I think we saw groups or we defined groups too much as if they were relatively homogeneous. We tended, I think, to devalue interactions within cohorts of international students as of less value than we should have. For, in fact, great diversity exists within the group international students as it does within a group that one might call domestic students. And interactions within those groups have always, of course, created belonging and networks and activities. There is an important distinction between affirmative models of recognition and relational ones, where affirmative models of recognition define groups with reference to their pre-existing characteristics, and policies often seek to protect that group so that its members can be themselves. Such thinking can be strategically useful when groups have been singled out for discriminatory treatment on the basis of those particular characteristics. However, these affirmative approaches can also become essentialist and confining. There is a more satisfactory idea of relational models of recognition in which identity groups are understood to be formed through a politics of difference rather than existing prior to these politics. And feminist concerns with intersectionality are important here. The idea that our identities and attributes form and iteratively reform within a range of processes and situations of which we're a part. And so individuals and groups cannot be adequately described with reference to one defining attribute statically. So my Canadian colleague Linda Peake refers to the importance of what she calls the constitutive outside in understanding identity. A third feature of diversity thinking is that it can actually camouflage or hide differences, unjust differences that render groups of individuals as unequal. This was what Nancy Fraser emphasised in her argument that justice thinking about economic inequality often fails to see how the cultural politics of difference also marginalises people, and vice versa. Recent discussions about workplaces have also pointed out what a focus on diversity can hide from us. So Sarah Ahmed, in her book written in 2012 on being included, has examined the adoption by institutions, universities in fact, of the language of diversity. And she investigates, quote, what diversity does by focusing on what diversity obscures, that is, the relationship between diversity and racism, unquote. And she notes that once institutional discourses of diversity arrive, a relative silence about terms like equality, social justice, and equal opportunities also arrives. Racism as a judgmental practice able to be identified in the workplace, she finds, is discursively and imaginatively more remote once diversity is an institutional norm. So in the minds of some critical analysts of organisations, diversity has become decoupled from its origins in 1970s progressive thinking with social justice aims. It has become a management aim seeking competitive advantage. If this is a view from critical management studies about the use of diversity in organisations, how does diversity sit in our social planning interventions in the built environment and our conceptualisations of life lived in the city? Writing like Leonie Sandercock's does showcase the importance of seeing diverse ways of living and making sure a variety of voices are heard and incorporated into our interventions in the city. Such research is very significant for its making visible the voices that must be heard. But the question then is how to know those presences and ways of living without judging them pejoratively, and how to recognise them relationally rather than statically and affirmatively. A range of alternatives is emerging in urban studies from this critique of diversity thinking and its focus, its narrow focus on recognition. Marking diversity and difference is still a highlight, of course, in progressive work in urban studies, but the focus with these alternatives is on the sitting together of diversities produced in any given situation. Perhaps with acceptance that our cities are by definition heterogeneous sites of multiculture, we can now accept that recognition of single identity groups as a practice of diversity thinking has had its day. But knowing the drawbacks of mainstreaming everything, which are that the less powerful amongst the different lose their place in an unidentified public, is it possible to see diversity as lived in the moment and multiply expressed rather than presumed in advance? Can we see diversity sitting together rather than separating them from their fellows? I think we can, and that focusing on collections of diverse groups in their togetherness has some interesting possibilities for reinvigorating ideas, our ideas of the social in planning and in urban studies. So let me go on to my third section, where I'm going to be talking about seeing diversities sitting together analytically instead of singling them out. So I'm going to take three conceptual entry points to thinking about diversity from this alternative view of seeking out diversities in their togetherness. And they have, of course, much in common, but I want to single them out for discussion. And they are encounter, The Invisibility and the Stranger, and the Urban Commons. And I hope that taking these three entry points to the study of diversity or the inclusion of diversity in our practice might provide food for thought about the social as it may exist in planning, particularly if we seek to avoid those harms that might arise from singling out outsider groups for their difference from insider groups. So first of all then, encounter. This is obviously one about encounter. There's a great deal of writing going on at present about encounter in urban studies, and I think it's possible to use the encounter as an epistemological strategy in comprehending how individuals and groups relate to each other in the material and political context of the city, through its built forms, its institutions, its place-based cultures. That is to say, one can choose to view people in the city as participants in encounters, primarily, and build knowledge about that, rather than seeing people as residents of certain suburbs or certain kinds of housing, or as members of defined groups statically located in certain areas of the city, as the population census might depict them. Indeed, to see individuals as solely members of certain fixed groups is to miss the fact that individuals do take up opportunities to be someone other than those fixed selves when they interact with those who have characteristics different from their own. And importantly, to see individuals too narrowly like that is also to neglect the role of urban planning in giving people opportunities to step sometimes into the shoes of others. Encounters are interactions of the moment, often convivial and sometimes not, sometimes fleeting and with unknown strangers, such as at a music festival. Equally, they can be with people who are familiar to us or accountable to us because of the context in which we meet them, even if we don't really know them personally, such as meeting with a real estate agent or a service provider to whom we can go back again, or seeing regulars in our local cafe. Writing on urban encounter, though, does tend to see that activity as myriad micro-scale examples of interaction, often across difference, which are to be documented for their evidence of the richness and complexity of urban life and made visible. So we see this, for example, in the writing of the Sydney sociologist Amanda Wise, who describes the people who sit in her local food court in her shopping mall and how different they are, rubbing shoulders together. Now, the convivial possibilities that encounters like this appear to offer should not, of course, be overdrawn. And in a recent review of what they term the convivial turn, giving rise to studies of everyday multiculture, British authors Neil and Vincent emphasise that maintaining interactions between people of cultural and indeed class differences requires competence, dedication and skill, labour really. Physical proximity is not enough. Their study of the details of friendship development between the parents of schoolchildren from different ethnic and religious backgrounds in a British locality really demonstrates the ongoing effort involved in avoiding withdrawal from difference and the effort required for cultural translation between group members. Other writing about urban encounter documents examples but seeks also to ask of their significance. To what positive and progressive outcomes might some encounters give rise but not others? So Jill Valentine, for one, has been concerned, it claims, that envisage new kinds of urban citizenship deriving from intercultural encounters that would see the development of cross-cultural programs in sites like schools as potentially scaling up a broader respect for difference. She's found that proximity and contact doesn't necessarily lead to respect for different others, and that they can even cement divisions and prejudice. So Valentine's position really clearly emphasises the normative ambiguity of the encounter, that it may be a source of progressive or regressive outcomes. I don't see the ambiguity of encounter, the uncertainty of outcomes associated with it, as a reason not to foster it in the city, in our social planning endeavours. In critical writings on urban diversity, we are generally hostile towards separation and confinement as strategies for dealing with the messy diversity and disorder of city life. It follows that conviviality and contact are to be encouraged as giving some meaning to urbanity, for the alternative is segregation, which is unthinkable. Examples of a convivial encounter in Iveson's and my writing have included things like street festivals, public libraries and community drop-in centres. And clearly these actions centre often on decisions taken by the state in its planning role. Equally clearly, however, these examples are not tiny, fleeting and local in all their aspects, because they're tied to the presence of infrastructure whose spatial reach can be large as much as it can be small. As Ashamin notes in his comments about how the sociality of the city cannot be reduced to the immediate moment of the encounter, it's important to bring urban infrastructure into what he calls the transactional field of the encounter between strangers. Other encounters occur within the home and within workplaces, within the activity spaces of the city. We can't assume that encounters are only in public spaces or in facilities provided by governments. So encounter, then, is one frame of reference that positions interactions as a centrepiece of the analysis of urban diversity and its planning. It encompasses interactions that are fleeting, all the way through to interactions that are massed, repeated, and sustained through time and space. It emphasises the importance of bodily presence, of physical and material togetherness, emplaced and in the moment, and the contingency of the outcomes that might ensue. Its normative possibilities are ambiguous. We can't guarantee that all its outcomes will be positive and happy. Nevertheless, its use as a mode of thinking avoids singling out groups and the harms of stereotyping that may come from doing that. So I go on to my second kind of new alternative in thinking about diversities in their togetherness, and talk about the question of invisibility or imperceptibility and the idea of the stranger. So if one is seeking to divest diversity thinking of its focus on identity, then some writers have claimed that a certain invisibility or imperceptibility akin to being a stranger is a norm through which to emplace people in some contexts. This writing seeks to remove the labels that classify us and our self-classification through them, deriving as these labels do from bureaucratic attempts to manage us and our differences. The figure of the stranger has been very important in analysis of city socialities. So our Iris Marion Young, that wonderful writer, famously defined urban life as, quote, a being together of strangers, unquote. Yet there is some question about whether the stranger is an invisible or imperceptible or unlabeled individual. In one commentary writing about undocumented migration in Europe and drawing from the thinking of Deleuze about the idea of social actors as always becoming and evolving, Papadopoulos and Tsianos argued that, quote, interestingly enough, the end of all becomings is not the proliferation of diversity and difference, but its disappearance. Becoming imperceptible is the imminent end of all becoming. It's a process of becoming everybody, everything, of eliminating the use of names, unquote. And their example is of undocumented migrants seeking settlement in a new country and destroying the documents that identify them before they're assessed for refugee status. The migrants want to become imperceptible or invisible. And this provides an important example, which indeed might be, I suppose, be extended to new arrivals in a city seeking to find a place there socially. Perhaps this way of thinking leads to support for claims of universal strangeness, claims that we're all strangers to ourselves or we're all strangers together, and that becoming everybody is a way that this fact will be understood. Do we thus go back to an overarching social? But one may query whether, far from becoming imperceptible, the asylum seekers in Papadopoulos and Tsianos' account are in fact actually delabeled by their actions. It's one thing for those so labeled to reject the positions they're given in a difficult context, to want to refuse labels, but they are labeled even without their consent. So I note in addition that the concept of the stranger is used in urban studies and much other social science because it is an identity or label positioned in a certain context, not a non-identity and a source of imperceptibility. Sarah Ahmed makes this point in her 2000 book. In her discussion of how the figure of the stranger is produced, emphasising that the stranger in a given time and place is not the stranger that might be inherent in everybody or the stranger that we do not know, but rather a quite specifically characterised individual. Further, she says, quote, to conclude that we are all strangers to each other is to avoid dealing with the political process whereby some others are designated as stranger than other others, unquote. In fact, Ahmed argues that the very discourses that emphasise multicultures, ideas of hybridity and of becoming, themselves reinforce boundaries and the figure of a specific stranger, even though it is their intention to do precisely the opposite. They name the fact that certain bodies are out of place and do not belong. She says they hold others in place. So seeing the production of strangers and strangeness as a political act in a context that has a history and a place, we can examine the claims of those wanting to resist labels in a new light. The asylum seekers in the previous example are not moving towards a depoliticised state of strangeness that is common to us all. Rather, in relinquishing bureaucratically imposed labels from the nation they are seeking to leave, they are taking on new identities imposed by the nations that do not want to receive them. Closer to my home, in the project of mine to which I referred earlier about student immigrants from overseas establishing themselves in central Melbourne, claims not to be thought of in terms of institutionally imposed labels and identities were made. One interviewee was quite clear that he wished to divest himself of the label always applied to him, that of being a Chinese student. This label meant he was constantly expected to be in a group of Chinese co-nationals as if they were his preferred familiars, and to be seeking interactions with local Australian students from his identified point of difference as a Chinese student. He had, he said, not come to Melbourne merely to be thought of as Chinese. His interest was in classical music, and he wanted to associate with others, no matter what their ethnicity, who shared that passion with him. The lack of sophistication of the labelling he endured really surprised and pained him. We see that one way of delabelling people, even if momentarily, may be for them to participate with others who share their interests, as in the micro-publics identified by Ash Amin as grounding and positive for urban life. Such activities may reduce the tendencies to be held in place, for participants to be held in place, if we use Ahmed's term. So the search for a delabeled strangeness requires us to shine a light on those processes that cause certain people to be labelled as unlike, outsiders and strangers, and to query the harm this may cause. Rather than imagining a world without labels, a better strategy is to seek to reduce the strength of harmful labels by pointing out the work they're doing in shaping the social relations of urban living to everyone's disadvantage. So I go on to talk about the urban commons, my third example, and this is just a slide of a web page of a really major one of these near where I live. So into the critical urban studies literature is creeping the idea of the commons. There are a lot of things the urban commons is not, and different perspectives on what it is. The urban commons is not the homogeneous public and its public interest, nor is it a synonym for public spaces and their awkward presence in between the ever more favoured and dominant private property rights in the city. The term does not describe necessarily the activism of urban social movements or particular urban publics pressing for a right to the city on the grounds of community or collective property, and perhaps pitting this against private property claims. Nor indeed are the urban commons a direct application to the city of the ideas of Garrett Hardin and later Eleanor Ostrom about overuse by individuals of shared resources and how to combat this. So the urban commons is not a statically definable thing either, like a land use, but rather something formed often politically in response to outside pressures that often seek to enclose it. As Nick Blomley says, it is produced and reproduced, not found. In this sense, an urban commons is the production of interactions and encounters in the city and collective action taken as a result of those interactions. An urban commons is formed in action and in practice. As David Harvey has noted, it's formed in the process of what he calls commoning. And he says, quote, "There is in effect, a social practice of commoning. This practice produces or establishes a social relation with a common whose uses are either exclusive to a social group or partially or fully open to all and sundry. At the heart of the practice of commoning lies the principle that the relation between the social group and that aspect of the environment being treated as a common shall be both collective and non-commodified." unquote. So one important recent addition to thinking about the urban commons is the claim that one is not, with these commons, necessarily dealing with a situation of scarcity in which the more users get involved, or the larger number of users becoming involved, the less there is for everyone. And the claim is that the reverse, in fact, can be true. So Borch and Kornberger have pointed out in the city that the commons is not a resource waiting to be used up or appropriated by citizens. And they claim that since the city constitutes its subjects, as they say, the more interactions around a commons occurs, the greater the process of commoning, in Harvey's terms, and the larger the urban commons that results. Now, that's their claim. Now, this interpretation of the urban commons, this last one, might be seen, I think, as somewhat less than useful analytically, in that it equates the city by definition with the production of commons, because the city is by definition the sites of encounters and interactions between diverse individuals and communities. But to me, there needs to be more specification of when one is seeing a commons and when one is not. Harvey, as I've said, argues that commoning is creating something outside markets and commodification. Some analysts, and I think I'm one, see that as a bit too rigid. So, for example, in the case of housing cooperatives, it's very hard to disentangle them entirely from housing markets. In some significant accounts, a commons emerges from ethical decision-making by communities, however one defines those, who commit to sharing something together and are defined by that commitment. And Gibson Graham, in their book, A Post-Capitalist Politics, give a good sense of this, I think. So this characteristic of ethical commitment is not necessarily present in the idea of micropublics or what Armin calls prosaic collaborations. Gibson Graham explore aspects of ethical decision-making in the community economies they examine, including the decision to replenish or enlarge the commons that define these communities. So here the communal resource might be, in different contexts, affordable housing or community gardening facilities or worker-owned and community-based producer cooperatives. So this definition of the commons is clearly at odds to some degree with that proposed by those who see an urban commons as involving no scarcity because it has no confining resource base. I think the ethical basis of commoning might usefully be understood as its enactment of equality occurring through the making of a commons. So we in planning and allied disciplines and practices might reflect on how actively we consider the social in the production of any urban commons in which we engage. I don't think it's necessary to situate the production of commons entirely outside the market or the state, as nothing can be entirely. But I do think it's useful to think of the urban commons as having an ethical, or as some might see it, a political or normative purpose, as it enacts equality in its dealings. And in this context, I have a challenging comment from a community services provider from the city of Dandenong in southeastern Melbourne, the most ethnically diverse municipality in that city. And I see in these comments perhaps an attempt to start an urban commons by an employee of government who is seeking to form an ethically founded community of equals, ranging explicitly across difference and in the interests of something which all participants share, child well-being. The fact that this employee is using governmental programs and resources to enact what I see as commoning, I don't think matters. I'm interested in the task of seeking out commons in the city and that we might look for sites of practice in all sorts of places, including the state, for these examples. So the quote I give comes from interviews in a placemaking study in which I was involved in Dandenong a few years ago with Kate Shaw and Marie Pardy. And I want you to see how this community services work, as described in the quote I'll read, focuses ethically on forming a commons of maternal and infant health care via a social role for government, for social planning. And you'll see how the community services manager or social planner here is really committed to both recognition and redistribution as norms for providing services to immigrants, but his municipality struggles with the recognition task when recognition is based on ethnic and national identity and the way in which that's articulated very precisely by the immigrant and refugee groups themselves and when economic need is so great too. So the interviewer said, "Do you find the cultural diversity a challenge here?" Nice general question. And the Municipal Community Services Manager said, it's a huge challenge, and on he went. We have 150 nationalities and half of them want their own dedicated space and we can't give it to them. They put a lot of demand on us, huge. Elected local councillors get quite reactive to it. They get very conservative. To the outsider, it could be interpreted as racism. It's actually protection from setting up precedents. You say yes to one and you open the floodgate to all of them and our budget isn't going to handle it. The maternal and child health model, as you will know very well here, is a universal model of access for mothers with babies built on a European white Anglo concept. 15 minutes for a session where you can be in and out, baby weighed, a bit of advice. Here in Dandenong, sessions are each 45 minutes and you have to have an interpreter, so the cost overlay for us to manage is large. And we're funded on a universal model from the state government and local council kicks in the rest. But I've got to tell you, the state government doesn't give us a bonus for the complexity that we deal with. You run that across every arm of community services, across aged care, family services, early years, library services. There is a cost infrastructure, he said, for doing the right thing, and we don't get funded to do it. The ratepayers of the community pay for it, so multiculturalism has a huge impact on this community. And he went on, some critics have come and said, well, that's wrong, you're reinforcing cultural difference. But we're saying we get the message about services like maternal and child health within the cultural setting. Here, sometimes it's the community elders that have more say than anyone else. We have to figure out who they are. It's a very complex social fabric here. Our service model and delivery system has certain inbuilt assumptions, however, about that, and we struggle to understand the nuances sometimes. So, unquote. So I think we might ask ourselves if the planning activities that we know of are actively seeking to create a commons, forming equality across difference as an ethical and social collective act in the way that community services personnel and social planners in local government were trying to do in that example. Where are the equivalent ethically formed and equality-making commons occurring in planning interventions for places? I've read of one urban designer who's written of the need for built forms in big commemorative public spaces of urban renewal to represent the interactions and interdependencies between social and diverse social groups in the city. She calls for these edifices and structures to see interactions as clearly represented, rather than presenting local history as the achievements of certain well-recognised groups or individuals alone. So recognising interconnectedness via the commemorative built form and its planning is a challenge, such as that faced by the community services provider I quoted earlier, but one that a functioning urban commons calls for. I think we will find instances of commoning in planning endeavours, sometimes led from within the state, such as Kurt Iveson and I tried to identify in our book when we searched for examples of ethical or justice-focused planning practice enacting norms of redistribution, recognition and encounter. A justice focus is there in many initiatives, and we must see and name these rather than being overwhelmed by enactments of injustice that we cannot avoid seeing. We can read the city's planning for successful practices of commoning in the same way that Gibbs and Graham have emphasised that we must read for economic difference, not only for the dominance of capitalist social relations in community economies. So perhaps it is in the urban commons that a form of encounter that is normatively less ambiguous might begin to be evident. So I'm going to move to a brief conclusion. So taking up the idea that there are new ways to work with diversity, pushing it beyond the recognition of difference and seeing it as a term that can reanimate older ideas of the social, I've noted the beginnings being made to conceptualise diversity usefully through the range of norms that can inhabit it. And with the materialistic turn of contemporary urban studies that has us focusing on actual activities, practices and interactions in the moment, we can go beyond a too easy labelling and categorisation of city dwellers. I note that in no sense does this remove the need to acknowledge the identity categories that are borne by city dwellers in their lives, because this is how they are seen by others and by institutions. This is how we are seen through the politics of difference and judgment in which we live. Classifications of our bodies are everywhere, legally everywhere. So I note Kurt Iveson's analysis of the legal battle in Sydney in the 1990s to retain McIver's pool at Coogee Beach, as you see in the slide, for the use of women and children, when men had used the equal opportunity provisions of legislation to contest this practice of reserving a public place for certain groups rather than others. This situation demonstrates how setting aside certain public places or activities for certain users under some conditions is just. It follows that cross-group programs that focus on interaction and which fund that interaction should probably not replace identity funding programs because, as has certainly been found in Amsterdam where they tried to do this, and as we saw in the quote that I gave from the community services manager in Dandenong, people need to be part of acknowledged communities of familiars even as they reach out from there to new interactions in micro-publics or urban commons. I want to say that I think we in urban studies and geography and planning are lucky to have our understanding of the importance of place underpinning everything we do, because it grounds the norms we work with and it shows us how social processes, including interactions, are space and time contingent. Our need to be accountable to the way things are in places would probably rescue any of us from too singular a focus on identity groups in isolation, because we would observe the interactions in the places they inhabit spatially as a matter of course in the everyday. Being grounded as we analyse situations in cities and their planning allows us to see specifically what harms a focus on diversity might help us address when we use the term diversity to describe encounter and interactions rather than for singling out groups of others or strangers. So in this talk, I've wondered how our research and practice on urban diversity and the social might be repositioned if pushed away from attribute definition and recognition as its major norm and practice. And I've argued that perhaps diversity, that very slippery term, could come to be seen not as primarily about that singling out and being accountable to difference, but as about finding and facilitating differences and equalities sitting together collectively and being experienced in counterpoint to sameness and inequality. And if current discussions about in-the-moment interactions in the city can help us identify particular harms that are being overcome or indeed generated by those interactions, for example, certain sorts of segregation, then they do offer us a useful way forward when we analyse in planning when we put in practice our strategic interest in planning the social. In particular, what Amin has called micro-publics, activity-based practices based on interest rather than identities, and also ethically-based practices of commoning, are forms of interaction warranting a lot more scrutiny, I think, for the enactment of equality they may demonstrate. Peter Hall, had he worked in this field of social planning, and had he been involved in interrogating diversity to see what its normative impact might be in our thinking, and maybe he was involved in that, as Michael mentioned, he would certainly have found wonderful examples from around the world from which we could learn. He would have found places and situations in which, on the whole, we could say there has been some success with justice-directed planning that has acknowledged diversity within its populations, but also facilitated people's purposeful interaction. He would, of course, have tried to bring the lessons from these situations back to the UK. At the very least, I like to think he would have ensured that thinking about what it means to plan for the social would be a serious part of the core practical curriculum in planning education, producing awareness of the varied interpretations of a diversity and their practical consequences in the city. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Ruth, for that rich and subtle analysis of the question of diversity and what it means for us as academic and practical planners. We now have some time for questions. And I think there are some roving mics which are going to be made available for that. There's a lot for us to think about in what's just been said. So I'd like to open the floor for questions for Ruth. And we'll have about
to have
until about
just hang on to this.
Hi, thank you very much for your presentation. I guess my question relates to the broader question is, where do you draw the line? In the sense that I come from Canada, which is usually seen as a place that is very diverse, and when you respect that diversity while at the same time allowing people, they integrate into the Canadian community while they remain who they are.
Yep.
However, as you were going through some of these concepts, I couldn't stop thinking about the fact, the example you gave about the Chinese student,
yep,
who didn't want to be labeled as Chinese. But on the other side, there's also so many other people who keep arguing for that this is who I am, and you are not addressing that in how you plan for the city and the services they're providing. So I guess my question is, where do you draw that line? And how do you engage people for them to understand why you're doing, why you're planning for them in a certain way and avoiding other
ways?
Scenarios?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a great question. Of course, there are no easy answers to this. And I think that one of the things that, and this was my point about place at the end, one of the things that we who work in urban planning in either practice or in academic work really know to our deepest core is that everything is contextual. So what I think I've tried to argue here is that we have this conceptual apparatus. We have some really interesting critiques of certain ways of proceeding, and we, as I've tried to indicate, are aware of some of the harms that can be done if we trundle along in a certain direction rather than being aware of the harms that might be being done there, but that we have an apparatus that we can work with. So as you very much strongly say, if there will be people who really do want to be acknowledged principally as members of the Chinese community, equally as there will be people who want to step outside that or feel that that's been really overdone and they're sick of it and they want to go and spend time doing other things. So I guess the task of the planner in any particular situation is to be aware of those possible entry points to the task of planning and try and work out which is the best way in the context at hand. And certainly the work in Amsterdam, which I'm sure you're all very familiar with since it's not very far from here and you probably discuss it a lot more than we do, where there were attempts to get rid of identity-based funding, ethnic community-based funding, and go into a model where people only got funds if they shared together with a bunch of others, was that that was unsatisfactory for a range of ways. So they're doing both, and I think that's probably all I can say. This is a conceptual apparatus. You see the critiques, you know the pitfalls, you devise it in the best way you can for the situation at hand and try and involve the local communities as you do.
Claire.
Many of the students will go on and work in the public and the private sector, and many of them, especially those who remain in the UK, will be obliged to see like a state and tick the boxes of seeing through categories everything,
yep,
that you describe should be doing, because this is what the Equalities Act requires and
what, yep,
you do when this exists in other forms elsewhere. So in a way, the planners of tomorrow are going to struggle between a very old-fashioned way of looking at recognition that the legislation imposes on them and perhaps being nurtured by new ways of thinking about the commons, for example, or social media and how it could be used to bridge across groups. So if you had to speak to these future young planners here, how would you, in a way, give them some practical ideas on how they can sort of reconcile this being old, being bounded by legislation that, you know, sees through these very neatly defined categories, and I know them here in the UK. But how could they embed new practices or new good practices? You gave example at the end of your talk, but perhaps to ask you to elaborate on some of these good ideas to inspire.
Yeah.
Your planners of tomorrow that are sitting here.
Okay, thanks, Claire. And I have to say, from my vantage point, this is not old planning, this checklist stuff. This is really quite recent. So I guess what I'd say is that we have those lists of identities of people within the community with various characteristics for a reason, and it's important to acknowledge that there are people in many different communities, and as we just said in the previous question, who will identify with those. So I think the message is not to give up on this, but to be aware that there are a whole suite of other ways of perhaps recognising people's difference and respecting it and acknowledging it, that can be equally well used. I think on the issue of seeing like a state, one of the most, and I don't remember whether I put this in the book and whether you will have read it, but probably I did, one of the most interesting comments on the state where many planners work that I've seen in the last few years, in fact, comes from the Canadian Alison Mounts, who's written of the state and of therefore of planning departments as places that themselves are peopled. These are not monolithic decision factories. These are places where people who are planners and who were planning students and sat here and listened to us talk about these different critiques will go to work. And certainly there will be pressures on them, but there will also be space for them to have creative ideas. Think about the social planner from the city of Dandenong who really was working tremendously hard to see what he thought was the right thing to do with multiculturalism in that you know amazingly challenging situation. So he needn't have done that. He could have just said, "Oh well, too bad. I'm not going to worry about it." But he did. So I guess that is what I would expect of people going out and working in planning jobs in NGOs or government or the private sector, that they are peopling those organisations and they are aware of these new critiques and this new knowledge that we're developing about social planning. And so the task is that difficult one of trying when they can to bring those new ideas into the practice that they see, whilst not rejecting totally the checklist that we've taken from the 70s and beyond that has been valuable to us already.
Thanks for that, Ruth. It's a great presentation, and I just maybe think a lot about a number of things. I suppose the one thing I wanted to just maybe challenge you on a little bit is that there are a lot of things that you didn't say in the talk about the debate on diversity, and I wonder if you just elaborate a bit on them. So there's the writing of people like Walter Ben Michaels on this about how we fell in love with diversity and learn to ignore difference, learn to ignore the inequality, in fact, learn to love inequality, I think he says somewhere, and that he argues that diversity is a handmaiden of neoliberalism, which in many ways you could argue that that's what Nicholas Rose was saying when he was talking about the shift from the social to governing the community, the soul, making us all Hobbesian individuals who hate each other and compete against each other. And it creates loneliness, it creates difference, it creates fracturing of people's lives and destroys the social. It's a very, very politically charged critique to me, a very political economy critique in many ways in some of that work. I just wondered, listening to you, whether you might sort of say, well, isn't neoliberalism really the problem in a way? And the fact that the urban commons response to me was an interesting set of interventions, but it seemed pretty small scale, given the crushing inequalities that exist in many societies at the same time as we talk more and more about diversity.
Yes.
I work a bit in this field.
I know you do, yeah.
I found that the more I work in it, the more I think diversity should be absolutely purged from the political scene. And maybe intellectually that's me to also really highlight those things.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I completely agree, Mike. I mean, yeah. And as you know, I said to you earlier, the title for that book that Kurt Iverson and I wrote, which was Planning and Diversity, was one foisted on us by the publisher. the diversity term, I agree with you, is a very slippery one, and it's used in particular political ways in very many contexts, and it is, I mean, this is the Sarah Ahmed point, it is used to disguise, or it sits in the presence of the disguising of major inequalities, which, as we know, are increasing. So, I mean, I think I would really like to see discussions on inequality and increases in inequality be housed under that term diversity, because we don't seem to be able to get rid of the term diversity. But I completely agree with you that it does accompany lack of attention to some of the other things, which many people now will see as more pressing. I mean, there are many people, I think, within social planning, urban geography, who really regret the challenge to Marxian political economy analyses made by feminism and multiculturalism because of the sort of attention it's taken away from things like the formation of neoliberalism and its Then, as you know, there are some people who argue that even within neoliberalism there are some interesting possibilities, which, however, as you say, are probably quite small. So I mean, I agree with you that there's, if we could get rid of the term diversity and just go back to the things that we're now trying to insert into it to give it meaning, maybe that would be a better way to go. On the question of the urban commons, and indeed the question of those forms of encounter which we might be able to see as normatively progressive, I think you raise a really interesting question about the scale of those and the scope of those. And I mean, this is a debate, and I don't have an answer to this, and I haven't actually ever seen a really good response to it, but this issue of the scaling up of things like commons initiatives or progressive encounters or whatever is one that comes a lot into social science and planning now. You know, how can we possibly argue that these things are significant when they're so minuscule? I mean, what does it matter if people in Detroit are planting community gardens when you see what's happened to that city and so on? So I actually think we can't be overwhelmed by that, and we have to keep looking for examples of justice thinking and progressive work being done, however small, and that if we look for it, we might find a few more examples than we were expecting. But the scaling up question is a very difficult one. With encounter, the sort of Ashar Min's arguments about thinking of infrastructure as in terms of encounter is actually a way of looking at scaling up that idea. So I agree. So I don't think I disagree with you in the slightest.
Is it all right? Okay.
Yes. Thank you. As you were talking, I was sort of making connections with our everyday teaching and research. And as you talked about encounter, that's obviously something which is right at the heart of the central problematic of urban design, spaces for encounter. And as you talked about strangers and labelling and identity, that's obviously something which is right at the heart of our discussion about place-making and place identity and territoriality. But then when you talked about urban commons, I wasn't sure, and even less sure when you turned it into a verb and talked about commoning.
David Harvey did, and one must always quote him. Yes.
David Harvey, I don't think, may not be the best prophet for thinking about take-home lessons for planners.
Possibly not.
You spoke about commons, and one of the problems is that it's not clear who is doing the commoning and what time scale they're doing the commoning. I mean, what a school of planning is always doing is thinking long-term and thinking structural and thinking of settings. And there is a lovely word which you didn't use, or a lovely phrase, which is public realm. Mm. And it's lovely because it both carries all Hannah Arendt's or Jürgen Habermas's philosophical depth, but it's also an extremely practical physical world, meaning footpaths, public spaces, parks, and community gardens. I just wonder, isn't it better to speak of
public realm? Not worry about all these other funny terms. I mean, you raise a good point, Michael, and I think probably where I differ from you a bit is that, and maybe this is my being a social geographer, you know, more than a planner these days, is that I see all of these debates about the six things I talked about as being about people's activities in the city rather than spaces. So I see, you know, identity form, and certainly they are activities that occur by virtue of the built environment and in built environments, but I really see that what I'm talking about are the daily activities of people in the city. So the commoning, that funny making a noun into a verb thing that Harvey has done, is about people doing things. And I think one of the things I sort of tried to slip in was that an increased emphasis on this sort of thing is coming, I think, in critical geography because of the emphasis on activities in the moment and the comment I made about people critiquing the use of norms, not being able to identify norms before they are intuited in practice. So the focus on everyday practice and immediacy in making outcomes is really very strong in many forms of critical geography. So in that sense, I'm not talking about a public realm as a set of spaces, or public spaces and private spaces particularly. I'm talking about activities within the population that occur within those spaces. So.
Okay, yes, sir. Thank you very much. I have two questions for you. Firstly, it's to do with the responsibilities of the planning profession itself. I think looking at this room, one notices that it's not actually very representative of the UK planning. If we talk about the UK planning profession, it is, and it seems like it is more, it is always the diverse that are interested in the diverse, in a sense. And also it's to do with the next question I have, is this idea of collaboration and the need for more effective modes of collaboration. I mean, to pick up a point that was said earlier, was that planning is a long-term thing. Yes, that is indeed true, but I also think there's the issue, the latest immigration figures that came out, for instance, state that they're more short-term, there's an increase in short-term immigration in the UK. And I think this notion of the temporal aspect of diversity and how one deals with how you actually integrate it when you have a shorter time period, and how do you collaborate for it? And is it more that we need more advanced tools of collaboration to tackle the constantly changing diversity that we encounter? We as individuals don't have time to comprehend it.
Yeah.
I think it's we live it, we learn it, and really we need to talk to those people who are actually more, who have actually lived more diversity.
Themselves. Yeah. Yeah, that's an interesting couple of questions. By the first question, were you meaning that the planning profession in the UK doesn't exhibit the forms of diversity that you would want it to?
No, it doesn't.
It doesn't?
Well, let's not take the UK, let's take London, for instance, because it's clearly it is the most diverse city we have in the UK, but the planning profession doesn't represent it. So, those who are actually diverse, who have experienced diversity, will actually practice diversity by default. So if they actually exist in the profession, I think we'll get
you've got a better chance. Yeah. Certainly no one could disagree with the need to have the profession and, you know, university lectures and so on all reflect the nature of the community in a range of ways. I think the question you raise about collaboration is really interesting, and though I hate to mention her, Leonie Sandercock has written quite widely on the issue of who is a planner. And if we see those who plan our cities and those who plan our communities and participate in urban commons and so on as only the official planners that we're all training to be in planning schools, then perhaps we'll miss the range of activities that many other community groups engage in, often with planners, formal planners, and how they have amazing outcomes for the city. So I think you're quite right. I mean, the diversity of our cities is enormous, and now we have the conceptual tools to recognise it's not just a range of different people from different cultural backgrounds. There's diversities present within those groups in multiple ways. So we have the conceptual tools now to recognise diversity in myriad different forms, more and more and more. But I think the only way we can do that, as you say, is you can't expect all of those to be reflected immediately in the planning profession when they, you know, become visible to us in the community or when they appear as new citizens. So the way to think about that, I think, is, and possibly to improve our collaboration, but is to include as planners a range of other people within the community whose actions actually affect our cities as well.
Thank you for that lecture. It was really interesting, and I think that what you talked about documenting good examples is cheered me up a bit, because working in diversity and difference in planning is quite depressing. So I wanted to just pick up on this point where you talked about the possibilities of urban infrastructure, and obviously in your book you talk about libraries and so on, but just about the reverse, about what about the limitations? And I just wanted to know your perspective on work, for example, in black geography, which has looked at these carceral geographies, particularly in cities such as Chicago, and the role of urban planning, housing and so on, in creating public housing, these carceral spaces, and the movement of the population between essentially prison and public housing. So thinking about that, I mean, and that it's still ongoing in places like, well, Taylor Holmes, that even in the regeneration there's a very sort of controlled presence around the public realm, or the open commons, about what people can and can't do, particularly African American populations. Yeah. So I think the question is about not so much about how we scale up, but how does recognising or working with good practice, does it fundamentally change things in terms of, you know, diversity is a nice term because it doesn't make anyone feel too bad, but what about these other structures?
Yeah, and well, indeed. And I mean, that's the fundamental question. That's Mike's question as well. And I'm often accused by Oren Yuftahel and Margot Huxley and my colleagues in planning of being a bit Pollyanna-ish and on the only focusing on the light side of planning and not enough on the dark side, which is what they focus on. And there most certainly is a dark side, and I certainly agree that, and it's often racialised, or very often racialised. So we certainly should continue our critiques and exposure of those. I mean, there's a fine history of a dark side of planning associated with public housing in the US in particular. But you know, there are also some amazing things that the women who live in those public housing blocks have done as well. And so I guess all I'm saying is that the inequalities that we know are existing and expanding and still being done in the name of planning as well as in the name of other institutions have to be documented, and we have to know those and be up to date with them. But that it's also important not to be entirely constrained by those bad examples and to look for the lights as well, to look for the light as well as the dark.
Okay, I'm going to draw proceedings to a close here. So I'd like to first of all remind you that after this event you're invited to the South Cloisters to join us for drinks and I think some canapes. But finally, I should conclude by thanking Ruth on your behalf for a very stimulating lecture about a topic which is central to the research and studies of many people in BSP. A topic which is incredibly relevant to the future of this city. And one which she's brought to bear a very sophisticated and thought-provoking presentation. So could we conclude by thanking Ruth in the traditional way?